thank you so much for everyone coming out to welcome our distinguished guests. For me, I think it's called Densetsu in Nihon, which means Legends Night. And I have the esteemed honor and pleasure to introduce our friends and brag about them. And from left to right, we have our Rinban, Kake Nakagawa of our church. We have Kenso Howard Zenimura. We have Fibber Tsuneo Hirayama, Rob Fitz, the author of Mashi's book, Masanori Murakami, and myself, I'm Kerry Yo Nakagawa. And I'm just going to kind of go down the line. And number one, I want to thank you all for taking all this time to come out on this nice, cool day. Last week, it was triple digits, and Mashi, I'm sure, remembers those days here in Fresno when he was a pitcher. But I'm sure glad the baseball lords have brought him good weather. Today, they were visiting the Saiki family, what we call Hakumaiti, taking flowers to the cemetery, to the family that Janice Saiki's out here. And their family took such great care of Mashi when he was here in 1964. I want to thank all the Dharma Center people that really has made this a wonderful day. It takes a lot of people to organize something like this. And so Hunter, Arakawa, Rumi, Rinban, Reverend Allen, everyone part of the church, Angel Moreno of the Fresno Bee, who wrote this wonderful article promoting Mashi coming today, and he's writing another one as well. So all the people that helped put this together, the UJCC, the United Japanese Christian Church, Fowler Buddhist Church for promoting our event tonight, and ex-players and friends, and all of you, thank you so much for being here to welcome Murakami-san back home to Fresno. So what I'd like to do is kind of introduce our guys, and starting with our senior ball player, Howard of Zenimura, Kenso and Kenshi, his brother, way back in 1953, represented our great city. They were on the 1952 baseball team, which to this day is one of a lot of people say one of the greatest baseball teams that Fresno State ever assembled. And at that point, Kenichi Zenimura, who we consider the father of Japanese American baseball, sent his two sons to the Hiroshima Carp. And when you think about the devastation of the atomic bomb and the Hiroshima Carp being the one community-owned team, most of the other teams like the Tokyo Giants and the Hanshin Tigers, they were all corporate sponsored by big industries. The Hiroshima Carp were basically a community team, and they were really inspired and elevated by the play of these two Fresno kids, Howard and Kenshi Zenimura. And then later, a teammate of theirs, Ben Mitsuyoshi, who was from Visalia, also joined them. So Howard, his path with the Carps, he was a Hiroshima Carp. He's in the Fresno State Hall of Fame for baseball. And like his father, who took tours to Japan as early as 1924 and 1927, he picked up the torch from his dad, who was the father of Japanese-American baseball in California. And he himself later became the president of the Fresno All-Boys League, and was able to give kids that were 15, 16 years old opportunities to play around the world. Brazil, and Mexico, Japan, Taiwan, China. And to this day, the league still exists. So Howard is quite a pioneer, as well as Harvey, as well as Ben. And then one of their teammates at Fresno State, who I'll introduce, Fibber Hirayama. Tsuneo is his first name. Fibber became his nickname. He also followed the path on Kenichi Zenimura's referral and played for the Carp. He played 10 years. He was an all-star at Fresno State, all-star with the Carps. He later went on to play for the Stockton Ports, became a Hall of Famer for them. The four-door Army team played with Stan Musial. Then once he got on with, after the four-door Army team played with the Carp for 10 years, he came back to Fresno, became an administrator, and then still stayed within the organization and went to the Dominican Republic and coached and scouted with great Reds player, Cesar Geronimo, and became a scout and a coach for the Carp, and saw this gangly kind of shortstop with the softest hands he had ever seen before, and referred them to the parent club in Japan. And the Carp signed him. He played 2 years with the Carp, and then later became the famous all-star Alfonso Soriano. So Fibber had quite an eye for talent and being able to pick out great future major leaguers. And to this day, he still goes back to Japan every year to visit the new Hiroshima Stadium, and is still quite an ambassador for the Carp. Rob Fitz, he's Mashi Murakami, which Rob will introduce, but a little bit of a background on Rob, who a friend, an author. He has a PhD from anthropology. He's an archaeologist, an expert in slavery in the 18th century. But in 2000, his passion became Japanese baseball. So his books include Remembering Japanese Baseball, Wally Yonamine, The Man Who Changed Japanese Baseball, Banzai Babe Ruth, Baseball, Espionage, and Assassination during the 1934 tour to Japan. And of course now, Mashi, The Unfulfilled Baseball Dreams of Masanori Murakami, the first Japanese major leaguer. Rob is a leading expert on Japanese baseball cards, and his website is www.robsjapanesecards.com. Now, Mashi Murakami. In 1964, I was 10 years old, and along with my street urchin friends from the Fowler Red Cats, that's where I was born and raised, we would come up to the games the Fresno Giants would play, and in the back of Euless Ballpark, if some of you remember, they had a barbed wire fence with a hole in it. So the kids that were small enough, you could squeeze through and get in free. I was one of those kids, and a lot of times on the backside of Euless, there was a street where if Rob Deere or Will Clark or some of the greats that we enjoyed watching, Jimmy Rahart would hit a home run, you could get that ball and either keep it or take it back in and they'd give you a free soda. Well, one night I got one of the balls and I came back in, and that's when Mashi came in 1964. And I remember just in awe watching this huge, gigantic pitcher from Japan. And there was two other players that were based on, they were exchanged from Japan as well. And I just remembered watching Mashi pitch, and after he signed my baseball, it gave me hope that, you know, if Mashi could be a professional baseball player, then here's a person that kind of looked like me or my uncle or my relative, then maybe I could be a professional ball player. So for all our kids, especially that were Nikkei or Japanese Americans, I know that Mashi represented hope and inspiration that maybe we can do it too, like him. He didn't last long with the Giants because he was called up from Fresno to the parent club and became a great reliever for them, and then came back again and played with Hall of Famers Willie Mays, Orlando Cepeda, Willie McCovey, who are also my heroes. So tonight, I'm really proud to be a part of this panel where every one of these people that you see on this panel are my heroes, or densetsu, which we call legends. And last year, we honored, last year Mashi was honored with the San Francisco Giants for his 50th anniversary for pitching with the Giants. And prior to that, another hero of mine, and which Rob wrote a book on him as well, Wally Yonamine from Hawaii, went to Japan and really became kind of the Jackie Robinson of Japan. And opened up the doors, much like Fibber, and Howard and Harvey and Ben did with Hiroshima Carp to usher in this whole new wave of this bridge across the Pacific, is which I call it. And when they played for relatively hardly any money. Nowadays, these players are making multi-millions that are major leaguers and going back to extend their career in Japan, as well as players much like Mashi remembers, you know, Nomomania, and Hideo Nomo came 30 years after Mashi and started this wave of future Japanese players. And now that door and that bridge really flows freely. So to be able to honor players like Wally Yonamine and Mashi Murakami with the Giants was a very special time for me. And last year I got to wear my Uncle Johnny's Fresno Athletic Club, kind of a throwback vintage uniform. And instead of Sergio Romo catching Mashi's first pitch, I was able to catch Mashi's pitch and spend some time with him again. And I'll never forget, as they introduced him, to see this wonderful tribute to his career and to feel the plate that I was going to get set up behind. And I had a vintage 1930s catcher's mask. And in fact, in the dugout, Mashi and I were sitting there ready to get introduced. And Bochy and his bench coach, Wotus, said, "Hey, that's a nice uniform and mitt and catcher's mask." I said, "Yeah, it's from the 1930s. And he goes, "Well, that's when Bochy was catching." You know, he had a nice smile before when we came into the dugout. And after he said that, he got all grouchy. And I wish Wotus wouldn't have said it. But, you know, it was, for me, surreal to be able to sit up behind home plate as a catcher. That my son used to, he was an all-star catcher himself. And he said, "Dad, don't let that ball that Mashi throws get by you." And I said, "There's no way." And but to think that that's where Posey sets up, and to think how many home runs we saw Barry Bonds hit for splash hits, and for me to be able to set up down there. And so as Mashi came to the mound, he acknowledged the whole crowd. And I remember putting a one finger down fastball. And instead of most celebrities getting in front of the mound, he got right on the rubber and threw me a perfect strike. And so I did an Emmett Ashford, you know, rendition and tribute and rung the batter out, the invisible batter, took the ball to Mashi, and his grandson came up to us. And for myself, that was one of the, I've had amazing moments in baseball, but that has to be right up there with one of the greatest, to be able to catch Mashi's first pitch last year. So at this point, I just want to introduce our author friend, Rob Fitz. He's going to kind of walk you through and show you a nice multimedia trilogy or story about Mashi's career. And then afterwards, we're going to do a book signing in the adjoining room, and Fibber and Howard will be here on hand to sign as well. So Rob Fitz, welcome.
Well, we're here today to celebrate the 50th anniversary of Masanori Murakami becoming the first major leaguer from Japan. And of course, the publication of our English language biography of Mashi. We're going to start today with a film. The film is a clip done by documentary filmmaker Yuriko Romer, who unfortunately could not make it here tonight. It's 9 minutes, and it's from her upcoming film, Diamond Diplomacy. And just so you know, it's she's 2 years away from production. So these clips you can see are a little rough. They still have copyright information on them. But I think you'll enjoy it anyway. So we'll start with that, and then we're going to turn the mic over to me and Mashi, and we're going to tell Mashi's story.
Years ago. All right, Mashi. Thank you.
Most of the ballparks were taking up the occupation. at a staff meeting and said, I'm a doctor. I said, you know, the morale of the Japanese people is down real low. And of course, I popped out and said that baseball would be a wonderful thing. Said, what do you mean by that? And I said, well, the Japanese love baseball, and I think if we brought a baseball team from the United States to play exhibition, I think the morale of the Japanese people would really, you know, be lifted up. And I said, well, what are you waiting for? First thing that came to my mind was the Lefty Odu, because he was so popular in Japan.
カレッジ行く予定をしたんですけど、南海ホークス、今ソフトバンクホークスのマネージャーが私の家にスカウトして、で私はノープロフェッショナルって言ったんですけど、帰る時に、If you sign the contract sent to United States, starting the baseball って言った途端に、A change of mind.
50 years ago, history was made as the first baseball player of Japanese descent played for a U.S. Major League Baseball team.
In his Major League debut, he pitched one scoreless inning against the Mets, and history was made. Mashi spent parts of two seasons with the Giants playing alongside Hall of Famers Willie Mays, Willie McCovey, and Orlando Cepeda. His overall record was 5-1 in the bigs, but he won the hearts of thousands with his courage on this historical journey.
And throwing out tonight's ceremonial first pitch, please welcome former pitcher for the San Francisco Giants, all the way from Japan, Masanori Mashi Murakami.
したかったわけですね。重役さんが電話してきたら、とにかく帰ってこい。それで、行く前に、もうサインしちゃったわけですよ。こっちでね。イングリッシュのコンタクトはよくわかんないで、それで行ったらトラブルになっちゃって、自分の人生には悔いがあると。あと何年かプレーできたらよかったなと思うんですけど。
I left my San Francisco, high on a hill, it calls to me to be where little cable cars.
Nakagawa also, who's a huge Hiroshima Carp baseball fan. He grew up in Hiroshima. And so we have a, not only is he our minister, but he He's got a great baseball and an archaeologist like Rob. So Rob, if you need any help in translation, Rebun can help.
Okay, thanks. I don't think we'll need help until the question is answered here. Okay, so tonight I'm going to be your narrator as Mashi and I tell the story of him becoming the first Japanese to play in the major leagues. So Mashi was born in 1944 in the small mountain town of Otsuki, about 30 miles west of Tokyo. He learned to play baseball for the neighborhood kids, but his father didn't like baseball. His father had fought in the war in China, and he'd seen the horrors of war, and he wanted Mashi to help people when he grew up. He wanted Mashi to become a doctor. So when Mashi went into middle school, Mashi wanted to grow up to join the middle school baseball team, but his father absolutely forbade it. Instead, he signed up Mashi for extra school after school, cram school. Well, that didn't last too long. After a while, Mashi started playing hooky and joined the baseball team on the sly. Now, we know that his mother must have figured it out when she did the laundry. You could see those telltale signs of dirty knees from sliding on the bases, but she kept it a secret. But one day, in the middle of practice, he looks up and his father's walking across the field, heading straight to the manager's office. He's like, oh, you know, my baseball career is going to be over this afternoon. But somehow the manager managed to convince his father to let him stay on the team if he could keep his grades up. And he did. Now, Mashi brought this small middle school team to the regional championship. Did so well that he gained the attention of a national baseball powerhouse known as Hosei II High School in Kawasaki, Japan. They gave Mashi a full scholarship, and he moved down into the team dorms in Kawasaki and lived there for the 4 years of his high school. Now, as you probably know, Japanese baseball is very closely influenced by the martial arts. There's a belief that practice should not only increase your skill on the diamond, but also increase your fighting spirit, increase your soul, if you will. And the belief that a team with a stronger fighting spirit might be able to overcome a better skilled team. Now, their managers came up with many ways to do this, long, hard practices. But one way they did this was to forbid their players water. And Mashi, will you please tell us a little bit about your high school and the lack of water and how you overcame that?
Okay. I was in high school. My first day, young players go in the club, over 150 people, players come, but they cannot play in the practice. They stay in the home to the left pole and the right pole, standing. And we start up after the finish the study, maybe 3 o'clock every day. Maybe finish the 7 or 8, 4 or 5 hours. But now we never get water. The 4 hours, never. The older guys, oldest is they can drink. But young, first years, never drink. But I am a pitcher. Then I go pitching, they get undershirt is sweat. Then I go to club and change the undershirt. That time I looking like this way, nobody there. I go to drink the water very quick and go like this. But other players cannot drink, no chance. Our field is outside the field. If somebody hit the foul ball, ball is go to the rice paddy. Rice paddy is maybe wall like this. Then
everybody go pick up the ball, then go in the rice paddy, then he took a towel out of the his pocket, then put in the water. Put in the water and then take in the water like this. But that's what it is, not a baby mosquito. Yes, it's okay. If that baby mosquito dies, what is not so good? Just living, you know? Then, after, you know, practice sometime, go running. Then next day, maybe 50 players don't come, then release. 10 more days after, again. Then they don't come. You know, practice so hard, then they don't come. And release this. Then 30 years, or maybe 30, 4, 5 prayers. Only, you know, very hard path. Yeah.
So Mashi did really well in high school baseball and grew the attention of pro scouts. But he didn't want to turn pro. He wanted to go into college and become a Japanese salaryman. So he kept on telling those pesky scouts, no, I'm not interested. Until one day, the manager of the Nankai Hawks, Kazuto Soroka, came to visit his house.
Okay, my high school is not so good. Too much accident. But the first year, we are, summertime, we are champion, Japan champion. That time, manager asked me, you want to play the bench? They go to the coaching. I said, it's up to you. I said, it's up to you. He said, okay, you are more chance than the other second guys that go in the bench. That time we are champion, the first time. Next year, spring, I was a bench. Then we get the champion. But I'm only one time to pitch. But I have the pennant, you know. Then second summer time, I'm very good. Sometime maybe cold game, the 5 or 7 innings, I pitch to strike out. Or 5 innings, maybe 10, or 7 innings, maybe 13, 14, strikeout. But that time we start the Kanawa area. Then first days, I go pitching. Manager said, oh, you, 2 days, you are pitching only, okay. Then I start pitching, almost finished, you know. Maybe 3 more. Then manager calls me, hey, Mashi, come on, you, he pitches the hitters. Then I go. I cannot say that. Manager said, say something. Oh, never say no. Yes. Then I pitch. First hitter, second hitter, third hitter hit to me. Line drive to over here and broke the ball. Then I cannot pitch that. No question. The next year, I'm very good. My 3rd year is good, but summertime, before the, maybe 3 weeks, I get hot stomach. I cannot eat 1 week. Then start the season, but pitching so-so. But summertime, so, sunshine, tired, then what's the two more games win better, but I lost because I cannot stamina. I don't have my knees is like this, cannot throw, then lose. But after the season, I go back to home, August. Now SoftBank Hawks manager, before Nankai Hawks, manager came to my home. Then he said, oh, sign up, Nankai Hawks. I said, no. I'd like to go to college, then play the baseball. Oh, yeah? No, you better sign the contract. But I said, no. Then he go back to Tokyo, then night game. Then before leave my house, he said, hey, Mashi, if you sign the contract, he said, I send to you United States, study the baseball. United States? Then I changed mine. Because, you know, about 50 years ago, I'm a high schooler. Every Friday night, I watch Rohaido. Yeah, I'm very enjoying. Sometimes go to the movie, watching Hollywood star, Marilyn Monroe, and John Wayne, you know. Then Japan to America is the other side, the East, us. Then, that time, you know, never can come over here, very expensive. Maybe no, just, you know, keep the money, maybe year and a half. Then, oh, I like to go to United States anyway. Like, not baseball, just like to come over here. Then I signed the contract, yes.
His first year in pro ball with the Hawks, he was put in the Hawks minor league system. Now, he was just 18 years old. He comes from this little hick town out in the mountains. So, manager Soroka here decides he does not want to board him in the team dormitories, which are in the middle of the red light district in Osaka. So he decides to board him in his own home. So for the year, 1963, Mashi lives in Soroka's house, and he obeys the family rules, he has meals with them, he does chores, and the two became very close. Now, 1964 comes around, and the Hawks have a very strong team. They're very full of good pitchers, and they're not sure whether Murakami-san will make the starting rotation. So Soroka decides this is a good time to send him to the United States to study baseball. So the Hawks reach an agreement with the San Francisco Giants. The Hawks will send three Japanese minor leaguers to the San Francisco minor league system just for seasoning. And they come up with this agreement. The agreement is just 2 pages long, but it's written entirely in English. They send it off to the Hawks, and for some reason, the Hawks don't bother translating it. They just sign it. Well, they missed something. One of those points says, at the end of the 1964 season, if the Giants want to, they can buy the rights to any one of these players for just $10,000. So Mashi and his two teammates go off to spring training in Arizona. Mashi, can you tell us a little bit about your first spring training?
Yeah, I fly to the Haneda to over here the March 10th. Then look into the San Francisco and then to the Disneyland and Hollywood. Then went to the Arizona, Casa Grande. The Casa Grande is a campus place, the only one, nothing. Then, you know, start the practice. But that time, everybody, you know, asked me. I cannot speak English, not much, just only baseball words. And everybody asking, what's your name? What's your name? I said, Masanori Murakami. Oh, okay, okay. They said, okay. Your name is Macaroni Murakami? Masanori? Masamori? No. I'm not Italian. No. Then everybody said like that, you know. Then someday somebody, Masanori, they cannot say that Masa. Very hard. Then Masama. Then they called me the Mashi, Mashi star, yes. And that time, you know, in Japan, over here, very different practice. Over here started about 10 o'clock morning, maybe finished at 1 o'clock. After 1 o'clock, we take a shower and, you know, teammate playing the playing card. I watching the, just, you know, watching the card. But in Japan, start at 10 o'clock, then noon time, maybe 30 minutes lunch time. Then start, maybe finish at 4 o'clock. Then, if 4 o'clock is an old prayer, young prayers, maybe 5 o'clock. Then, after finish the practice, go back to the hotel, taking shower, eating dinner. After dinner, maybe 30 minutes, practice again. It's but swing and shadow pitching. Then maybe finish at 9 o'clock. Then maybe go to bed about 10 o'clock. The next day, cannot walk very, you know, my legs are tight. Then maybe warming up 30 minutes. After 30 minutes, maybe muscle is so soft, you know. Yeah, very, very, very hard, yes.
So Mashi's assigned to the Fresno Giants. And you may know that his manager was Bill Worrell. And Bill Worrell had a great influence on this story for two reasons. The first is he was a member of that 1949 San Francisco Seals team that we saw in the movie. So he'd already been to Japan. And he enjoyed Japan so much in 49, he went back again in 1951 with Joe DiMaggio. So he knew a couple words of Japanese, but more importantly, he was able to tell these American players to be sympathetic to Mashi and to try to include him. But Worrell did something that would actually change Mashi's life. Up until that point, Mashi was a starting pitcher. He had outstanding control, and Worrell needed a relief pitcher. So he moved him into the role now known as a closer. Now, what made Mashi so different from some other of the early Japanese players is he really wanted to embrace American culture and try everything. So in spring training, he tried his first hot dog ever, because they didn't have them in Japan back then. He didn't have an interpreter, and as he said a few minutes ago, he barely spoke English. But nonetheless, he would go out with his new American teammates to dinner, to the dog races, to movies, anything, just to try to understand more about this new experience, the new country he was with. So he did great in Fresno. You may know he won the Rookie of the Year. He was an all-star. He was among the league leaders in strikeouts, even though he was a relief pitcher, not a starter. So September 1st, 1964, the major leagues all are allowed to increase their rosters from 25 people to 40 people. So they call up minor leaguers to fill out the squad. And the Giants are in the middle of a pennant race, but they don't have a left-handed relief pitcher. They don't have one in AAA either to call up. So they decide to take a chance on this kid, this 20-year-old kid, all the way down in single-A Fresno. So they call him up to the big leagues. And Mashi, can you tell us about when you heard you were going to be called up to the major leagues?
I came up here about 6 months. Then I can speak a little bit English. And someday, August, maybe middle of August, you know, teammates talking in the clubhouse, blah, blah, blah. I go in, what you talking about that? They said, oh, maybe you too. I don't know what talking. The Fresno Giants has a good player, starting pitcher, Pedro Reynoso. He is, I think, 18, maybe. Then Bobby Taylor, center fielder, he's a leading hitter. And right fielder, Ari Brown, hit a home run and 300, you know, hit average, and I think still on base he got over 100 RBI. Then he's an MVP that year. But they said, "Oh, maybe you too." Then I didn't know that. Then they said, September 1st, Major League calling up the minor league players, the 25 players to the 40 players in the bench. Then the 29th, Bill Wall, manager, he told me that, "Hey, Mashi, you go to the major. Tomorrow, minor league owners come to the, after the game, tell to me." Then after the game, owner comes, everybody, you know, in the clubhouse, "Hey, Mashi go to the major league. Everybody come, congratulations, and good luck, shake hand." Then next day, I fly to the Fresno airplane, maybe 8:30 something. But nobody there, the Giants staff, nobody there. I don't know. Mrs. Saiki said, before leaving Saiki's house, she said, "If you go to New York, be careful, don't go out." Yeah, maybe, you know, somebody come to me, "Oh, it's a plane from Germany. Oh, come on, come on." Then maybe he take the money, you know, steal my money. But then I asked the United Airlines pilot how to go to Kennedy Airport flight. "Oh, you better go to that gate." "That, okay, thank you." Then flight. They arrived at Kennedy Airport. Nobody there, not Giant staff. Wow, I can go to the hotel, Roosevelt. Then I have the address and the name. Then I ask him again, United Airlines pilot. Other people, I don't know. The pilot is okay. Yeah. Then, oh, you better go to that limousine bus, go to the Roosevelt Hotel. Okay, thank you. Then I bring my stuff. Then I go in. I left the hotel, then check in. The counter, I asked the boy, "My name is Masanori Murakami, Giants pitcher." "Okay. Not your name?" "No." "Then, no name." "Looked again." I said, no name. "Wow. What are you doing? I don't know." Then I bring my staff to lobby's corner, they sit in the sofa. I waited about 20 minutes. The 20 minutes, you know, maybe over 1 hour. I think, if nobody come to here, what I doing? I don't have the, you know, air ticket to San Francisco. Nothing. Or maybe tomorrow morning, I'm dying, Hudson River, maybe suicide. I think, you know, never thinking a good one, bad one, yeah. About 20 minutes after, traveling secretary come. "Oh, are you a Japanese pitcher?" "Yes." "Oh, come on, come on. Oh, sign over here, okay." And take the room, but I waiting, maybe 1 hour, I'm hungry. Already 8 o'clock, very hungry. Then how to get, I go get, you know, food, I don't know. Then go down, you know, lobby, then lobby the restaurant inside the hotel. Then I go in, waitress comes. "Oh, you cook by yourself?" "Yes." Then she take it. Somebody called me. Hey. Oh, you're a Japanese pitcher? "Yes." "Oh, come on, sit over here." "Oh, thank you." He's, you know, one marshal. Yes. Maybe his salary is $80,000 that time. I'm not this much. Then I eat, you know, waitress comes to the, what you want? She saw the menu, but I cannot leave. So hard, you know? Sometimes a different name. Hamburgers, no. Different name. Then I eat same thing. Everything same. You want milk? Yes. Bread and butter? Butter? No, bread and rice? And bread. Everything same. Then in Japan, I eat that. Then finish. In Japan, you know, if called to the big guy, I'm a rookie, sit over here. After they eat, they pay for me. But after the finish, Juan Marshall pay $12, Jose Pagan pay $12, I pay $12. Wow. Pay for me, no. Next day, young players come to me. Then, you eat hotel, no good, expensive. You better to die. Well, no, he said, I take it. Other side, maybe $5. $5, enough the food. Then they take it to me. Yes, another place. Okay?
Okay. The next day was September 1st, 1964. It was the first day that Mashi was eligible to play in the major leagues. And after some confusion over signing the contract and some amusing stories, the game starts and the Mets jump ahead. In the eighth inning, they're up 4-0. And manager Alvin Dark decides this is a good time to see what Mashi has.
I played the practice start. Then my undershirt is like
Mashi. Can you just go right to the...
bottom of the seventh innings, finished. Then Alvin Dyer called to the bullpen, and if, you know, eighth inning, Giants no runs, Mashi go to the game, mound. Then we are 4-0, behind the 4 runs. Then Giants don't get the eighth inning, no runs. Then, bottom of the eighth, announcer said, now pitching San Francisco Giants, number 10, Masanori Murakami. Okay, I'm warming up already. Then, I face the door to open, walk in the field, out to right field, to mount. But so many fans, over 40,000 people, watching me. I cannot hear what they say. Before Fresno, you know how many people? 400 or 500 people. Not thousand. Sometime, maybe one or two times. Then if you're not afraid, you know, muscle tight, cannot pitch. Then I think, I look in the stand, you know, everybody say something. I don't know, I cannot hear. Then, oh, you know, that time, 1964, popular song over here, Sukiyaki. Then I walk in, la 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 la. Like that. Then walk in the mound. Then talk to the catcher, you know, about sign. Then I think first pitch is outside the corner, the first ball. Then catcher outside the corner, sign outside the corner, first ball. Then throw, strike. but by the fifth, Charisu. Yes, then I get struck out. Then second batter is a base hit. Then next hit is a struck out. Then next hit is a grand, short, maybe short, grand ball. Then after the eighth inning, the Giants get one run. If you know, I don't know who hit, somebody hit the three-run home run, the tie score. I wanted that because I know never thinking of winning, you know, pitcher. I like to more, one more inning, I like to pitch, ninth inning. But, you know, run.
So Mashi's debut becomes front page news, certainly in the San Francisco area of newspapers and the Fresno papers, but even the front page of the sports section of the New York Times. And actually all over the country, one of the wonderful things about modern internet is you can check out the newspapers from all over. And if you go to September 2nd, 1964, in the middle of Kansas, front page of the sports section is first Japanese pitches in major leagues. So Mashi Mania takes over for a few weeks. And among Mashi Mania, we get very bizarre cartoons in the newspaper. Here's some rare footage of Mashi. Very little surprise. He does really well in 1964 in this final month. The Giants challenge for the pennant, they come up short, but Mashi emerges as not only the best left-handed relief pitcher, but their best relief pitcher. So, the end of the season, naturally the Giants want him back. They get Mashi to sign a contract for the 1965 season, and they write out a check for $10,000 to buy his contract. And then they make a big mistake. They don't send it to Tokyo with a cover letter. They don't wire it to Tokyo with a telegram. Instead, they hand the check to a scout for the Nankai Hawks who happens to be in the United States at the time. You can just imagine the scout, you know, getting this check for $10,000. Oh, wow, thanks. The scout assumes that it's a thank you gift because Mashi has done so well for the Giants. So, in mid-December 1964, Mashi decides to return to Japan to be with his family for the New Year's. And he arrives at Haneda Airport and he's given a hero's welcome. Hundreds of people are lining up to visit him, I'm sorry, to welcome him. There's photographers everywhere, and there's autograph seekers. They decide to hold a press conference, and hundreds of people are packed into this tiny little room. And the first starts out really great. Now everybody's like, oh, you know, we're so proud of you. You know, what does it feel like to be Japan's first major leaguer? About halfway through, the general manager of the Nankai Hawks stands up and he says, Mashi's not going back to the San Francisco Giants next year. He still belongs to us. He's pitching in Japan next year. Here's a picture of Mashi and his father after the press conference going home on the train. Tell what he thought about that. So all winter long, the Hawks and the Giants fight over Mashi's contract. It lasted 5 months. It was known as the Murakami Typhoon in Japan. But finally in May 1965, they decide to reach a compromise. Mashi's allowed to pitch for the San Francisco Giants during the 1965 season. And then at the end of the season, he will choose where he's going to finish his career, in the United States or back in Japan. And supposedly, he was supposed to not be influenced by these two teams. No, that didn't happen. I'm sorry. So he comes back to San Francisco, and he's once again welcomed at the airport by throngs of people. He's front page, and once again, we have a really bizarre cartoon in the San Francisco Chronicle. And his teammates welcome him back. And he was particularly friendly with Willie Mays, who was a mentor to him, really looked out for him. And of course, Juan Marichal. and Orlando Cepeda about to give Mashi a big kiss for saving a game. Next. And here's Mashi at the Astrodome. Being an astronaut, of course. Now, Mashi was known for his sense of humor. He would occasionally play practical jokes on his teammates, but more often, he was the butt of the jokes from his teammates. Georg Perry, for example, liked to put rubber snakes in his locker to see him jump when he opened them up. Now, one of these, here he is with Casey Stengel. Next slide, please, I think. Nope, can you go back one? Yeah, how do you do that? I don't know. Doesn't matter, we'll leave it there. One of these practical jokes became front page news. And Mashi, can you tell the Herman story?
Oh, somebody knows about this story. I was teaching the Candlestick Park. I don't remember the what inning, but I went to the mound. That time, before the mound, I warming up the bullpen. That time, bullpen catcher, Jack Hyatt. When you go to mound, if Herman Franks come to the mound, you say something. Okay. Then I go mound. Then Herman Franks come to with Tom Hara catcher, the walking. Herman Franks pass the line. Then I said, Herman, take a hike. Then he said, what? Then he talked to the Tom Hara. I don't know what talk about. Then go back to the bench. I don't know where. I don't know me. Then about we are win the game. Then after the game, Herman Franks very happy because team is win. Then media people come to asking about this tonight game or something. Then he said, when I go to the mound, Mashi said, Herman, take a hike. Then next newspaper is. Masi said, Herman, take a hike. Yes, it's I think I didn't know before. Get out of here. I said to manager, I didn't know.
Unfortunately, we don't have time for this story tonight, but one of the players who truly influenced Mashi for the rest of his life was Roberto Clemente. And maybe during the signing, you can ask him to tell him a little bit about that. Roberto said something when he met this young rookie and said, someday if you become famous, make sure to give back to the rest of the people. And it that stuck with Mashi, and he's been very active in charity work ever since his retirement. And it's a good story, but unfortunately, we have to cut up a little bit short. So. Okay, so Mashi was a great hitting pitcher, actually. He only got two hits in the major leagues, but his first hit was off this fellow up here. Mashi, can you tell the Sandy Koufax first hit?
Oh, in Candlestick Park, that time I went to the at-bat, the pitcher is Sandy Koufax. Then he saw the first pitch. I say, Jim, the ball come this way, very fast. My button go like this, swing, maybe this much. I think never can hit his ball. That year, he's a 382 slugger. Then next, maybe he saw fastball too, because I'm a pitcher. I change my mind. Then he pitching, balls come and tries to bunt to third base. Then safe. Then my first hit is Sandy Koufax. Yes. One time I hit, my average 100. Yes. But I don't have the ball.
Okay, as you may know, that during his time in the States, two families boarded Mashi and in Fresno, it's the Psyche family. And they really helped him settle in. They showed him the ropes, they brought him out to meet people, they got him involved in the community here, and Mashi went to parties, and he writes in his diary something like, this is the greatest year of my life, because he just had so much fun. And here he is with the family dogs. And in San Francisco, he's staying with the Osaka family, who we will see tomorrow. Now, Kerry already touched on this during his wonderful introduction, but Mashi became a true hero for the young Japanese Americans, a symbol of what they could strive for, that there was a chance to become a Major League Baseball player. So I think Kerry said it much better than I ever could. So I'm going to kind of skip over this slide. This video dates to August 15th, 1965. It's Masanori Murakami Day at Candlestick Park. He's going to get his first major league start, and he's going to get a present. And we can all see that present there. Now here he is, and this speech is going on, and he's confessed recently that he should have been thinking about the game. He's going to face the Philadelphia Phillies, his first major league start, but he's not thinking about it at all. Because they had leaked that this present was going to be a red Mustang convertible. And he wanted that red Mustang convertible. Mashi, did you get your red Mustang convertible?
Oh, my ceremony, before the ceremony, about 3 weeks before, our Japanese people told me, hey, Mashi, you got the Mustang convertible. Oh, very good. If I take in Japan, it's a very expensive over there anyway. They are very happy. Then, before the 1 week, Japanese people told me, Mashi, sorry, you are Japanese. This sun, that sun fair is dead. They changed the car. Wow. How come? Like that. But I'm very happy anyway, happy, but I wanted Mustang much better.
And as you can see, he's very happy with his Robin's Egg Blue Datsun. Now, overall, Mashi was treated very well in the United States. Fans of all backgrounds cheered for him, home and away. And fans actually packed the stadium to places like Cincinnati and St. Louis to see the first Japanese in the major leagues. But there were some incidences, and here's one of them. There was a death threat to manager Herman Franks. If they played Mashi again, someone would shoot him. Well, it didn't happen, luckily. They put an FBI guard on him, and Mashi was completely unaware of it at the time. Next, please. So at the end of the 1965 season, Mashi is faced with a big decision, to stay in the United States or to go back to Japan. He loves San Francisco. He really likes staying in the United States, and he really likes playing in the major leagues. But in Japan, he has obligations. He's indebted to manager Soroka, the man who signed him, the man who let him come to the United States, let him stay in his home. And he chooses to go back to Japan. So Mashi, can you tell us about your final decision to go back to Japan?
Oh, you know, 1962, August, managers came to my home. Then he said, if sign the contract, send to the United States, then they know, give to me the contract, no send to United States. Just he promised me. Then I came over here and played the Fresno Giant and the Major League. Then he wanted back to Japan. He said, "He must come back to Japan." Then he promised me. Then I promised to him. I'm happy. But 1966 January, I went to the Yokohama. Tsuroka's friend, good friend. Then he taking the dinner. After dinner, then we went to the drinking place. Then I sit in the sofa, drinking, thing like this. Then I start singing song San Francisco. I wrote my heart in San Francisco. Then I cry. Then friend saw me. "You wanna go United States?" "Yes, but I promised Mr. Tsuroka." Then he said, he asked Tsuroka, "Maybe 66 plane over here, but if you go to United States, 67 back to Japan," he said. But I said, "No, I promised Tsuroka, it's okay, but my personal life is a regret, you know the regret?" "Yes, every time I talk to that." Then, in Japan, now Japanese people come over here, I hope if they like to come over here, come on. Yes, that's all.
Next one. So Mashi went back to Japan and pitched another 17, actually, one more. Yeah. Mashi went back to Japan and pitched another 17 years in the Japanese leagues. So when we were doing this book, and when I was interviewing him back in 2012, we got towards the end of the interview, so we did a week solid, 8 hours a day interviews with an interpreter at one point. And I was asking, what do you think, about going back? Trying to sum it up for me. And he said something that at the time was just a statement, but as I wrote it down and I looked at it later, I realized it's actually poetry. So it's in the front of the book, and we're going to finish with this. He said, "There was a grand stage before me, and I was ready to take it, but I could not actually go on. So many regrets." Thanks for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rob, Mashi, Fibber, Kenso. We were going to do a Q&A, but we have an Obon practice coming in. So we're going to usher Mashi and Rob to the next room. And we just really want to thank you for coming out. Mashi and Rob are signing the books. And then also, if you have articles that you want to sign, Mashi has now a foundation called the Masanori Murakami Academic and Athletic Scholarship. So proceeds to tonight's book signing and the artifacts will go towards this nice scholarship. And if there's any Nikkei college athletes that are in college, boy or girl, to please apply for a Mashi scholarship, because he's giving away four $2,000 scholarships, and it might be an annual situation. So please support the Scholarship Foundation, Rob's book. Thank you, everyone, Rinpon, the Fresno Buddhist Temple. And please come out Saturday for the Obon that they're having. There's going to be a lot of great food here Saturday, and dance for your ancestors, no matter what culture or how diverse our audience is. That's what the whole purpose of the Obon is, to dance for our ancestors. Thank you, Rob, Mashi.
Thank you so much for coming.